Oké, ik ben weer eens laat, dus ik zal waarschijnlijk wel niet op tijd zijn. Daily Minutes nummer 1547 met een uitzending van vandaag, 10 februari 2019. Dus op dat en van zondag. Today's bulletin will be in English, but we will start with something in Dutch. Vandaag is er het ERRL Audio News en verder is er de column van Onno. Op het laatst van de uitzending met veel dank aan Kees P1 RNL. Een viertal van de afbeeldingen die hij vanmiddag van het ISS wist te ontvangen. Extra bijzonder is dat het dit keer plaatjes zijn die door Amerikaanse astronauten zijn uitgezonden, maar ze hebben dat gedaan onder de Russische roepletters RS-0ISS. Vier plaatjes, ze zijn in PD-90 en PD-50. Oorspronkelijk was dat PD-120 vanaf het ISS, maar omdat er toch verliezen in zitten bij de overdracht was PD-90 genoeg en bij één ervan was dat zelfs PD-50.
This is ARRL Audio News, your weekly summary of news highlights from the world of amateur radio. If you retransmit audio news through a repeater, listen for the Morse code K character, followed by 4 seconds of silence. That's your cue to stop transmitting so that your repeater timer can reset.
I'm Carla Pereira, KC1HSX, and these are our stories for Friday, February 8th. ARRL is undertaking a new initiative to provide online educational opportunities to a broad range of radio amateurs. The Lifelong Learning Initiative will seek to provide a series of learning tracks that will serve the needs of the various interest groups within the amateur radio community. While designed for everyone with an interest in learning more about amateur radio, the Lifelong Learning Initiative will initially focus on creating online learning opportunities for new and newer hams, a segment of the amateur radio community desperately searching for education, instruction, and resources. The ARRL Board of Directors set the Lifelong Learning Initiative in motion, endorsing and funding the program and approving the hiring of advertising agency Mincent Hoke to work with ARRL Lifelong Learning Manager Chris Bickle, K1BIC, and other ARRL staffers in building this learning environment. Mincent Hoke will conduct the research necessary to identify the different educational needs within the broader amateur radio community. If all goes as planned, the initiative will launch in late 2019. The V84SAA de-expedition in the tiny Southeast Asian nation of Brunei, located on the island of Borneo and surrounded by Malaysia, is underway. 18 operators under the leadership of Krassy Petkov, K1LZ, will be on the air until February 18th, mostly on the low bands. All of North America will have some portion of common darkness within the V84SAA team. The best time to make contact would be at or before your local sunrise. For antennas, the team is using verticals on 160 and 80 meters and a 4-square on 40 meters. Plans call for 2 beverage antennas, one for Europe and another for North America. While the team will focus on the low bands, expect to find V84SAA on the higher bands, including 30, 17, and 12 meters. Scientists at the National Centers for Environmental Information, or NCEI, have updated the World Magnetic Model mid-cycle, as Earth's northern magnetic pole has begun shifting quickly away from the Canadian Arctic and towards Siberia. The alteration could have an impact on government, industry, and consumer electronics. Updates are typically released every 5 years, and this update comes about 1 year early. Other governmental entities use the technology for surveying and mapping, satellite antenna tracking, and air traffic management. Smartphone and consumer electronics companies also rely on the model to provide consumers with accurate compass apps, maps, and GPS services. Alexanderson alternator transmissions from Sweden's station SAQ on New Year's Eve drew more than 340 listener reports from 28 countries, including 7 reports from the U.S. The nearly century-old electromechanical Alexanderson alternator at SAQ transmits on CW at 17.2 kHz on special occasions. Amateur radio station SK6SAQ was also active on Christmas Eve on 75, 40, and 20 meters, with 2 stations on the air from the SAQ site in Grimton, Sweden. Members of the North Country DX Association once again are on-site and active from different locations in Alaska, Yukon Territory, Northwest Territories, Nunavut, and Greenland until February 28th. The RST suffix call signs being used include KL7RST, VY1RST, VE8RST, VY0RST, and OX7RST. Also look for N1RAC/KL7, which will be active from Fairbanks, Alaska. QSL all call signs direct via K7ICE. Additional details and information on how to obtain a free RST certificate are on K7ICE's QRZ.com profile or visit their Facebook page. From the early morning of January 27th, radio amateurs in Cuba's capital of Havana were keeping an eye on the weather. An extratropical low-pressure system in the southeastern Gulf of Mexico, associated with a cold front approaching from the west, was preceded by a line of prefrontal storms generating severe weather conditions that deteriorated considerably during the evening and night hours. Completely unexpected was an F4 tornado that caused considerable damage in Havana. While hurricanes and tropical storms are fairly regular occurrences, the tornado was reported to be the first ever to hit Havana. According to Radio Havana's Ari Coro, CO2KK, quote, "Once again, amateur radio operators proved how they could handle emergency traffic during this severe weather event, when the 2G and 3G mobile cellular phone systems collapsed due to damage and the excessive traffic generated by the event. Using the Havana metropolitan area main repeater on 145.190 MHz, stations with handheld FM transceivers could keep in touch from even the most difficult places in the affected areas, comprising the municipalities of Regla, San Miguel del Padrón, Habana del Este, and Diez de Octubre," unquote. According to media reports, the storm, with winds approaching 260 miles per hour, left at least 6 dead and more than 200 injured. Damage to homes and buildings was substantial. A Havana repeater on 145.33 MHz was pressed into service for the first time for this sort of event. A 144.410 MHz repeater in the affected area of Diez de Octubre proved very useful in handling traffic with medical workers, firefighters, and government emergency managers. ARRL Emergency Preparedness Manager Mike Corey, KI1U, has announced that he will depart ARRL on February 15th to pursue another career opportunity. He has been part of the ARRL staff since 2010. ARRL CEO Howard Mickle, WB2ITX, said, quote, "Mike has accomplished much during his 9 years on the job, including expanding the Ham Aid program, national disaster response, working with our national partners, and most recently, the rollout of Ares Connect. The headquarters team will miss Mike's friendly personality and wishes him well on his pursuits. As Mike is an active ham, there is a good chance we will run into him on the air," unquote. As part of the overall restructuring at ARRL headquarters, ARRL management will take the opportunity to examine the administration of the Emergency Preparedness Program.
And now with this week's satellite update, here's Bruce Page, KK5DO.
It did not take long for Oscar number 100 to be issued. On November 15th, 2018, Gutter's amateur satellite, which is the first amateur satellite in a geostationary orbit, or a P4A, as we call it, was launched. It was successfully tested in December 2018, and plans for opening it for amateur use are this month. The satellite is S-Hale 2. It is now called Qatar Oscar 100, or QO100. Congratulations to hams in Qatar and Germany who worked hard to make this happen. By the way, as this is a geostationary satellite, it is hovering over Qatar and not available to those in North America. The 2019 AMSAT 50th Anniversary Symposium will be held at the Hilton Arlington in Arlington, Virginia, in the Washington, D.C. metro area on October 18, 19, and 20 of this year. Further details are forthcoming, and we will keep you informed. This should be a very memorable symposium. Hope you're planning on attending. This is Bruce Page, KK5DO, for the ARRL Audio News.
This is the ARRL Audio News propagation forecast for Friday, February the 8th. The sun is as blank as a proverbial cue ball this week. That's the seventh day in a row without spots. but the solar flux index remains a bit elevated at 71. Keep an ear on the bands above 20 meters, and there could be a few surprise openings. There are geomagnetic disturbances in the forecast for the next several days, but these are expected to be minor and of little concern. As mentioned earlier in this podcast, you may want to set your alarm clocks and get up just a little earlier, maybe right before sunrise, for the V84 SAAD expedition in Brunei. 40 meters is likely to be your best bet then, but also check 20 meters later in the morning, usually between about 8 and 10 a.m. local time. On VHF and UHF, the West Coast has a quiet forecast, but things are percolating from Texas east to the Carolinas, particularly on 2 meters.
And that concludes ARRL Audio News for this week. Our thanks to all contributors to this week's report. ARRL Audio News is produced by the American Radio Relay League, the National Association for Amateur Radio. For more information on amateur radio or the ARRL, visit us on the web at arrl.org. You can also find us on Facebook and Twitter by searching for ARRL. If you have a question or comment about ARRL Audio News, email us at audionews@arrl.org. This program is copyright ARRL, all rights reserved. 73, and thanks for listening.
Foundations of Amateur Radio. We tend to spend most of our energy looking at antennas and power to evaluate how well our station works. Based on a better antenna or more power, you're likely to make more contacts, is the general gist of the process. Being a QRP operator, power rarely comes into the conversation. 5 watts is what you get, leaving antennas as the prime method of discovering how effective we can be. Recently, I received an email from Lane, Alpha Echo 1 November, pointing me at an article he wrote on the Nashua Area Radio Society website titled, "It's All About the Decibels, Factors in Enhancing Station Effectiveness." The article goes into great detail in looking at an alternative way of measuring how well you're doing and builds on the December 2013 QST article, "How Much Punch Can You Get from Different Modes?" In our hobby, we measure using a thing called the decibel. I've spoken about it at great length previously. The way to use it is to compare something against something else. Using the metric used in the QST article, we take as a starting point a modern transceiver using 100 watts, CW, into a half-wave dipole at 30 meters. Everything we're discussing from here on in is related to that starting point, the zero point. I should also make clear that we're talking about the ability of the receiver to decode your message, not the strength of the signal. If you were to use the same radio and instead of using CW, used AM, you'd have a station that was 27 dB worse off. That is, your signal would effectively become harder to hear by 27 decibel. On the other hand, if you were to replace the half-wave dipole with a 4-element Yagi, your station would be just under 7 dB better off. That is, it would be easier to hear you by 7 dB. Of course, you can combine AM and the Yagi, adding the two measurements together, coming out at minus 20 dB, which means that compared to a 100-watt transmission on CW into a half-wave dipole, the same 100-watt transmission on AM into a 4-element Yagi would still be harder to hear by 20 dB. If you go from CW to SSB, you'd be 17 dB worse off, or SSB is 10 dB better than AM. Note that when I say better and worse, it's about how much your signal can be decoded at the other end using the same receiver, antenna, etc. The whole article includes comparisons between CW and FM, CW and RTTY, and so on. RTTY is only 4 dB worse than CW, but most transceiver manufacturers recommend that you reduce power to a quarter power, that is 25 watt instead of 100 watt, when using RTTY or digital modes, so you end up losing 14 dB for that, making RTTY slightly worse than SSB, if you follow the manufacturer instructions to reduce power. This isn't all doom and gloom, however. Even though CW is very effective, we can improve things in other ways. For example, using PSK31 gives you a 7 dB head start. Switching from CW to JT65 or FT8 gives you 25 dB. Even if you take into account the reduction from the loss of full power, 14 dB, you still end up in front by 11 dB, which is more than you can get from upping the power from 100 watts to 400 watts, which only gets you 6 dB. Adding an 11-element Yagi gives you a similar improvement as changing from CW to FT8, just over 11 dB. And using 1500 watts is only slightly better, at 12 dB. The point I'm making is that you can use this idea to figure out how to get your signal heard. More power or a bigger antenna is only part of the conversation. Picking the correct mode is just as important. Of course, the 11 dB gain you get from moving from CW to FT8, even when reducing power, is one of the main reasons that it's so popular. Much easier to change mode than to build a new fancy antenna. One more thing. What of the 5 watts versus 100 watts we started with? 13 dB. That's significant, but if you were to use 5 watts FT8 into a quarter wave dipole, using 100% of the 5 watts, you'll actually be 12 dBs better off than the same station using 100 watts CW. Check out Lane's article for a reference to QST and a whole lot more. It's a very useful way of looking at how your station can be very effective, even if you're QRP. I'm Onno, Victor Kilo 6, Foxtrot Lima Alpha Bravo.
Daily Minutes zijn dagelijks vanaf ongeveer 1900 uur te beluisteren. De uitzending wordt een dag later om 10:30 ochtends herhaald. Alle mail is welkom op het adres x@xdv.me. Dat is ook te vinden rechts bovenaan de webpagina van de uitzending in www.pa0ete.nl. De Daily Minutes toont iedere dag weer aan de hand van schokkende voorbeelden hoe een hobby mensenlevens kan veranderen. De internetfaciliteiten en studiohardware voor Daily Minutes worden gesponsord door 70MHzShop.nl. 70MHzShop.nl.
En microfoon naar de tour.